हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ बायोकेमिस्ट्री ऑफ कैंसर. द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ बायोकेमिस्ट्री ऑफ कैंसर मेनली इंक्लूडेड व्हाट इज सेल साइकिल एंड हाउ इज इट रेगुलेटेड एंड द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ सेल साइकिल इन द कैंसर जेनेसिस. द सेकेंड पार्ट वॉज मेनली ऑन द डिफरेंट इटियोलॉजीज इन्वॉल्व इन द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ कैंसर एंड द पैथोजेनेसिस मैकेनिज्म इन्वॉल्व इन द the formation or development of cancer along with the different biochemical changes seen in the cancer. The third part of this lecture, biochemistry of cancer, focuses on tumor markers. So our objectives will be to know what are these tumor markers, what are the ideal characteristics a tumor marker should have, and what are the different uses of tumor markers in case of cancer, and what are the different methods used for the estimation of these tumor markers. So, tumor markers are nothing but the biochemical indicators for the presence of a tumor. These can be detected in the serum, in the plasma, in the urine or saliva or other body fluids. Most commonly used material will be serum or plasma, but it can also be estimated from other body fluids which I just mentioned. So what are these tumor markers? These are the substances present in a tumor or produced by a tumor itself or produced by a host in response to the tumor, which is used for the differentiation of a tumor from a normal tissue. So the definition of tumor markers is, these are the substances which are present in a tumor or produced by the tumor itself or produced by the host in response to a tumor, which can be used to differentiate a tumor from normal tissues, or they can be used to determine the presence of a tumor based on the serial measurements in the serum or body secretions. This is the definition of tumor markers. So what are the ideal characteristics of a tumor markers? The ideal tumor marker should be specific. That means its increased level should indicate the presence of a tumor. It should be sensitive and it should have long lead time and a short half-life. The tumor marker should be easily obtainable. The measurement should happen from a easily obtainable specimens, and the assay which is used for the diagnosis should be simple and cost effective. So these are the various characteristics an ideal tumor marker should have. So uses of these tumor markers, these are mainly used for screening, for the detection of the cancer, diagnosis of the tumor, monitoring of the tumor, and also in the identification of recurrence of a tumor in suspected early effectively treated cases. So the basic uses will be screening and early detection of cancer, for the diagnosis, for the monitoring, prognosis of the tumor, and also in the identification of recurrence of a tumor in an previously treated patient. So these are the different uses. So, the uses which I explained, screening. What is screening? How tumor markers are used in the screening? The tumor markers which I'll be mentioning in further slides, these the concentrations will be normally found in normal cells, but the concentration or the levels will be in higher and higher amounts in case of cancer patients. Otherwise, in normal patients or normal subjects, the tumor markers are present in insignificant amounts. So, screening for an asymptomatic population may result in detection of false positive cases. So, we have to be useful which tumor marker we are using in which cases, because sometimes increased tumor markers in an asymptomatic person may lead to false positive or false diagnosis of a tumor. So other than PSA, none of the tumor markers will be used for screening, because prostate specific antigen is the only tumor marker which is used in screening, because no tumor marker identified till date which can be used adequately to screen any asymptomatic population or patients. So only PSA is used for the diagnosis of screening. Next one uses prognosis. Tumor marker concentration gradually increases as the tumor size increases, reaching their highest levels when the tumor cells metastasize. So, tumor marker levels at the diagnosis can reflect the aggressiveness of a tumor and help to predict the outcome of any cancer patient. So, it is used in the prognosis. Third use, for the monitoring of the treatment. After any surgical removal or chemotherapy or radiotherapy, the measurement of tumor markers will be done at regular intervals to monitor the patient. In patients with elevated tumor markers at the time of diagnosis, once the therapy is given, there will be a dramatic decrease of these tumor markers, or there can be possibility of returning these tumor marker levels to normal ranges. So these are used for the monitoring of the treatment. So whenever there is appearance of these tumor markers after the effective therapy, it increased levels of tumor markers can suggest a possibility of recurrence in that treated patient. So it is used for monitoring the patients and also for the prognosis. So different methodologies are used for estimation of tumor markers, and which includes mass spectrometry, microassays, various immunological methods like RIA, radioimmunoassay, immunohistochemistry or ELISA, flow cytometry, cytogenetic analytical methods include FISH and spectral karyotyping. Genetic analytical methods include sequencing, RT-PCR and gel electrophoresis. And proteomics includes surface enhanced laser desorption or ionization techniques. And some other methodologies, different serological and enzyme assays, which you go through. So what are the different types of tumor markers which we see routinely? There are various types of tumor markers, which includes oncofetal tumor markers, which includes alpha fetoprotein and carcinoembryogenic antigen, different hormones like catecholamines, calcitonin and beta HCG, certain glycoproteins which include CA125, CA15/3, CA19/9, PSA. Certain metabolites which includes VMA, tumor associated viral antigens which includes polyoma and SV40, certain levels of enzymes increases in case of tumors which includes LDH, lactate dehydrogenase, ALP and ACP, that is acid phosphatase, and certain tumor associated proteins which includes immunoglobulins. These are the different types of tumor markers which are commonly used in the cancer patients. So I will briefly explain certain very few commonly used tumor markers like oncofetal antigens. These oncofetal antigens are normally present during embryogenesis and later on disappear, but their level increases again with certain types of cancers, and this includes most commonly used includes alpha fetoprotein and CEA, that is carcinoembryogenic antigen. Alpha fetoprotein is normally secreted by the fetal liver and the level disappears as the baby is born, but as mentioned earlier, the levels increases with certain types of tumors. So the most common use of alpha fetoprotein is in the diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma and germ cell tumors. and it is also used for the classification and monitoring of testicular cancer and in the tumor staging. One disadvantage with the alpha fetoprotein level is that the raised levels are not directly proportional to the size of the tumor, and the normal range of alpha fetoprotein is less than 10 mg per nanograms per ml. If the level is less than 10 mg nanograms per ml, the diagnosis of malignancy is ruled out. Second most commonly used oncofetal antigen, that is CEA. These levels of this tumor markers is normally elevated in smokers and in some elderly patients. But the most common cause for elevation in the levels of CEA is colorectal carcinoma and other cancers which with the high levels of CA include breast, pancreatic, lung cancer and other gastrointestinal tumors. In the breast cancer, it is used for detecting and monitoring of metastatic diseases. And in certain benign conditions also, CEA will be elevated, which includes cirrhosis, emphysema and rectal polyp. So whenever we are assessing any patient with CEA level, we have to keep in mind that in case of smokers and in elderly patients, the levels are elevated, and in certain benign conditions also the levels of CEA are elevated. So we have to be very careful. Next, certain hormonal tumor markers. Because some tumors produce different hormones, and they are often able to be identified and quantified by the different immunoassays which are used to measure these normally produced hormones. But the elevation of a given hormone will not be considered as a diagnostic of a specific tumor. And these are highly sensitive, but they lack specificity. So their utility is not much in the diagnosis and in the treatment. So this is the list of certain hormonal tumor markers which are used. ACTH, that is adrenocorticotropic hormone, is used in the diagnosis or management of small cell lung carcinoma. ADH, antidiuretic hormone, which is involved in the regulation of water balance, is used in the diagnosis or management of lung, adrenal cortex, pancreatic and intestinal tumors. Calcitonin, which is involved in the regulation of calcium. The levels may be increased in thyroid, lung, breast, renal and liver carcinoma. And gastrin, this hormone levels more than the 10 times the normal reference range. If it is elevated, it is used in the diagnosis of gastrinoma. Glucagon, a hormone involved in the homeostasis of blood glucose, the levels will be elevated in glucagonoma. HCG, which is normally elevated during pregnancy, but higher levels are used in the diagnosis of embryonal, placental cancers and testicular carcinomas in men and choriocarcinomas. This levels of HCG will be highly elevated in tropoblastic and chorionic tumors which are of embryonic cell origin. Insulin, a important hormone which is secreted by the beta cells from the pancreas, which is involved in the regulation of blood glucose, the levels will be increased in insulinoma tumor. PTH, the levels will be elevated in liver, renal and breast and lung carcinoma. And the last one in this table will be prolactin, which is elevated in pituitary, renal and lung carcinomas. Certain glycoproteins, which are also used in the estimation diagnosis of cancers, which most commonly used will be CA125 and PSA. CA125 is a glycoprotein with more than 200 to 2000 kilodalton weight. The levels of CA125 can be elevated in benign conditions and also in malignant cancers. The benign causes where the levels of CA125 increased will include endometriosis, ovarian cyst, PID, cirrhosis, hepatitis, and pericarditis. And even certain physiological conditions can also increase CA125 levels, and that includes pregnancy and menstruation. And other cancers which are seen or associated with increased CA125 levels will be most commonly ovarian tumor, and others includes lung, breast and GI endometrial tumors. PSA, that is prostate specific antigen tumor marker, which is the only tumor marker which can be used for screening of prostate cancer. PSA along with digital rectal examination is used in the assessment of tumor markers. Levels more than 10 nanograms per ml will suggest the possibility of prostate cancer, but it is not the diagnostic. Along with estimation of PSA, digital rectal examination and prostate biopsy will be confirmatory tests for the diagnosis of prostate cancer. And this PSA along with the diagnosis can also be used for monitoring hormonal treatment and for the identification of recurrence of a prostate CA following treatment. Next, certain genetic tumor markers, oncogenes and tumor suppressors. We have studied what are these oncogenes and tumor suppressors. List of these tumor markers include tumor suppressor P53 is used in breast, colon and lung cancer. Retinoblastoma 1 tumor suppressor marker can be used in retinoblastoma, that is Wilms tumor 1 and 2. BRCA 1 and 2 for most commonly used in the assessment of breast CA along with pancreatic and ovarian tumor. APC used for colorectal. DCC is used for colon and gastric carcinoma identification. Oncogenes which are associated with cancer: NRAS for identification of leukemia, KRAS for colon and gastric CA, NMIC for breast and neuro tumors, CABL BCR, that is for identification of CML, BCL2 is for identification of leukemia or lymphomas. This is the list of different tumor markers associated with different malignancy. Please go through the list later on. As I mentioned, the tumor markers along with malignant tumors, these are seen with certain benign conditions also. The levels of tumor markers can also be seen with certain benign conditions and which includes the following list. AFP can be associated with viral hepatitis, liver injury, IBD and in pregnancy. Beta HCG levels can be seen, increased levels can be seen in testicular failure, marijuana smokers and in pregnancy. CEA levels are elevated in smokers, IBD patients, hepatitis, cirrhosis, pancreatitis and gastritis. CA125 levels can be raised in peritoneal irritation, endometriosis, PID, hepatitis, pregnancy. PSA can be levels can be raised in case of prostatitis or benign prostatic hyperplasia also. So we have to be careful when using these tumor markers because their levels can be seen. The elevated levels can also be seen in these benign conditions and certain physiological conditions which we have read out just now. So this is again a list of tumor markers. Moving on to the next, limitations which are seen with tumor markers. The study of tumor markers revealed that no single tumor marker is useful for all types of cancer, nor for all patients with a given type of cancer. The levels of tumor markers are usually elevated in advanced stages of cancer, and these markers are most commonly useful in monitoring the response to therapy and in identification of recurrence after the treatment is given. And they lack specificity and sensitivity in diagnosis of cancer. As mentioned just a minute back, benign conditions also can have elevated levels of certain tumor markers. Smokers will have raised CEA levels. And since normal population will also have small amounts of tumor markers, these cannot be used for screening of the patients except PSA. So that except PSA. So that completes the tumor marker parts, which mainly included definition of tumor markers, characteristics of tumor markers, different types of tumor markers, methodologies involved in the assessment, and the limitations of tumor markers in the useful in the cancer management. So the take home message in the biochemistry of cancer class, which mainly says that cell cycle, we have learned that what is cell cycle. It is a single parent cell producing two identical daughter cells with duplication of the genetic material and cytoplasm, and this cell cycle is controlled by various cyclins. Cancer, we learned the definition, that is unwanted growth of uncontrolled growth of unwanted cells, which is multifactorial in origin. The basic pathology involved in the development of cancer is because of various factors which basically cause the alteration in the DNA, and it is also associated with various biochemical changes. And last one, that is tumor markers. These are the biochemical indicators for the presence of a tumor, which are useful in the diagnosis, monitoring, prognosis, and identification of recurrence of tumors. So this ends the topic, that is biochemistry of cancer. Biochemistry of cancer, the expected questions will be, what is cell cycle? Note on cell cycle regulation. Causative factors involved in the causation of cancer, the biochemical changes seen in cancer patient, and tumor markers. What are tumor markers? What are the different types of tumor markers which are commonly used? These tumor markers are mainly asked in your PG entrance preparation. So you have to study very much in detail for your NEET entrance exam this topic. For UG level, this much is sufficient, and that this completes your class on biochemistry of cancer. Thank you.